Okay, so we are live. And we have our first participants. So hopefully you can hear me. If you can, please write something on the chat so I know you're live. And welcome. Please write something on the chat so we know you hear us. Something. Thank you, Mickey. You have brought something. Great success. Okay, so we are about to start. I'm going to share my screen. And once again, I want to welcome you for joining us on our third Pi and AI meetup, of course, organized by Deep Learning AI and in collaboration with Nordius. So today's topic is a very interesting one, at least for me. And before I announce our speaker for today, I first want to do a small bit of shameless self-promotion. So please forgive me, but Nordius is hiring for a junior AI engineer to come and work with us and make AI for our games in the machine learning and artificial intelligence team. So if this is something that you find interesting, and it probably is since you are on this call, please take a look on our career website and do apply if you want to make, for example, human-like agents for playtesting games. So this is our topic for today. And our speaker is Jeppe Christensen. Jeppe is doing a industrial PhD at the Center for Computer Games Research in Copenhagen in collaboration with Tactile Games, which is a wonderful gaming company, also in Copenhagen. And I first met Jeppe on a conference in 2019, I believe, in London. And we've been great friends ever since. So I want to use these opportunities to say one big thank you to Jeppe for coming and for wanting to do this presentation for us. And I really cannot wait to see what you have prepared. So please take it away.
All right, thank you. Let me share my screen also. So I think you should be, it's cut 2 sec. Okay, does it look fine?
Yes.
Perfect. All right. So thank you for having me. I'm very excited to come and speak about it, and I wish I could be there in person, but now we have to do it like this. So I look forward to when we can all meet and, you know, do these and actually have pie. But so as Minash was saying, my name is Jeppe Christensen. I'm doing an industrial PhD in collaboration with Tactile Games and the IT University of Copenhagen. The topic for my PhD and some of the research is, as you guessed, creating human-like agents for playtesting puzzle games. And this is just right now a teaser. Hold on, let me... I want to have my pointer quickly. Like that. So... this is just a bit of the teaser of what I will show later, but first let me just go through what I will be presenting on this, and hopefully that is something you can find interesting and also follow. So first, I just want to motivate the business case of why do we actually want to create these agents. That's always good to start with, and then I want to talk about what are some of the state of the art reinforcement learning algorithms, or at least playtesting stuff, just to talk about why they're cool, and also second, why maybe it doesn't work in all cases like ours. And I will then go into what is my own research on this, the results so far, and how what problems have we encountered, and what do we think to do to deal with these. And then lastly, wrapping up and having questions from you. So let's start from the beginning. Why do we want to do this? So Tactile Games are making these kind of puzzle games where you have a level with a certain number of moves, and then you have to collect these goals within the move limit, and then you complete it. As it is now, there are more than 4,000 levels, and about weekly schedule, there's 50 new levels that are added weekly. And with the amount of active players, any bad player experience will also, it's important that we actually make sure that the player experience is good. It's not too difficult, and it's just right, these levels. So what we want to do is have something to improve the player experience, and specifically estimate the difficulty of a new release before we let players play it. So for example, that could look like this down here. So a new level release, we have here 75 new levels, and the difficulty here is the average number of attempts that people spend on completing it. And we don't want it to be too high, because then people will get frustrated and quit the game. And we don't want it to be too low, because then people are just going to breeze through the content, and we're not going to be able to monetize it. And so that's also something that, we want to make sure that what we release is a good, has a good difficulty. And with the amount of levels that we release in players, this is something that calls for some kind of automation. Now, you can start simple and create some scripts to play the levels, like some handcrafted scripts of behavior trees, and it's pretty straightforward, but it can be rather time consuming to get just right to, play like a player. And it also doesn't scale well, because what happens if we make a new gimmick or a new addition to a level or a new mechanic, then we have to revisit this, and it doesn't really scale. Another way you can do it is maybe if you have player data. So, in typical machine learning methods, you have some classification problem, and you have some labeled data. So you have some observations and a label, and you train some kind of classifier and say, this is a dog or whatever. In this case, we just say, this is how the board looks like. This is the action that the player takes. And then that is our model. That's an option, but it's a bit of a reactive way of how players are playing. It depends on what data we have for the players. And maybe it's not really what we don't even have player data. So it's useful, but it's not something that we necessarily can use in all cases. So what we want to go with is a reinforcement learning agent. So typically you see it represented like this. So you have some kind of agent that can take an action and interact with the environment. And then from this action, you go to a new state and get a reward out. So it's a way to have your method or your algorithm explore the dynamics of an environment. It's also something that we can use to explore new levels and so on. So maybe this is the way to go when it comes to creating something to playtest new levels. Of course, there's still some difficulties doing this. There are some difficulties just implementing it and using it in practice, but also very importantly, AI behavior is not necessarily the same as player behavior. And we don't have any player data to really correlate it with like we do in the supervised. So how do we make sure that there's some kind of correlation between the AI and players? Just to also, you know, address this business case. I mean, there are also, in my work at least, some design guidelines that we have to think about, because it has to be technically feasible to use in a company. So it has to fit in with the company tech. That's all, something you always have to keep in mind. And also in this case, we don't have play traces of players. So we don't know how players actually play the level. So that's something that you can, you know, it's different from game to game, but we don't have the very fine-grained analysis or possibility of tracking data for players. And we also have limited control over the game. We can't procedurally generate new levels. We are kind of stuck with the levels that we have. Of course, this is all something that can, you know, if you want to go that way, the company can support you to, you know, allow your method to do all this, but maybe they don't have time or they're too busy with other projects. So there are some technical limitations we have to take into account. Another thing is that we want it to be accurate and fast. So the people that use it, they have to be able to trust that whatever difficulty prediction they get out, they can trust that it's somewhat correct. And it also has to be fast enough, in our case at least. The level designers, when they try to iterate on a new level, they don't want to wait until the next day to test if this kind of gimmick they added is good. So it has to be fast. And then lastly, it has to be usable on new content. All right. So with this in mind, and the fact that we went with a reinforcement learning method, let's talk about some of the state-of-the-art reinforcement learning. And just very briefly, I just want to mention again what it is, or some typical terms. So when we talk about a reinforcement learning agent, we typically talk about the state, action, and reward. So the state is basically the game state, the board state, or could be the sensors from a robot or something. The action is the obviously actions that you take, the agent can take. And lastly, the reward. And the reward is it's the central part of reinforcement learning. So it's what you reward the agent for taking the right action. So that's typically what you want to maximize. You want to maximize the reward that you get in the end. Deep reinforcement learning is where you tend to then use neural networks to approximate the state, the expected reward, and so on. So you have more like classical Bandit methods or something like that, reinforcement learning. But when it comes to deep reinforcement learning and some of the stuff we will talk about now, you use neural networks for a lot of approximation, because otherwise it's impossible to describe the distribution of states and so on. Then lastly, there's also, you can maybe divide the classic approaches into like three or four different things. Many people think when you want to create an agent to playtest something, you need to go to the end of the simulation and see how it is. So like you do this tree search where you have to go to the end to update your action selection policy or whatever, but you don't need to go all the way to update your policy. You also have these temporal difference methods where you can update your method from just looking at how it the reward and so on that you get from just doing one step. Then lastly, you also have dynamic programming. So if you have a model or a perfect simulation of your game, you can see what happens with every action from one state and all the other actions. So you like exhaustively search through your space to find the best method. But that is something that tends to become very computationally expensive and not something that we will talk too much about now. But this is just to give an idea of what like reinforcement learning is very briefly. Now, maybe some of you are familiar with some of the very popular reinforcement learning agents. You have the OpenAI 5, which is what was able to play Dota 2. So they had this at the international tournaments, and you know all the hype about them beating the world pros and being better than them, and now AI is going to take over. That's maybe what many of you know about when it comes to playtest or AI agents to play games. But OpenAI also has this gym library, which has a number of different reinforcement learning methods and environments that you can play with. And this tends to be a pretty good place to start to, you know, try and play with reinforcement learning. Another big hyped up company is DeepMind. So they have this Alpha Star that can play StarCraft, and you know they had a lot of the same hype that this Dota 2 bot had. But also DeepMind also has this MuZero, which is an latest iteration of their whole AlphaGo, AlphaGo Zero models. So there was at some point this big piece in the news about they just beat the world champion in Go, and Go is such a difficult domain to work with because all the possibilities. So there was a big achievement. And now the latest method, this MuZero, it doesn't even need to know the rules of the game, so in order to play and plan. And so that enables it to also play these Atari games now, these different common video games stuff. So it's all very impressive, the work that they have done. Like, in order to create a good agent in this environment or in this domain, you have to know something about, include knowledge of like game theory. You have some rock, paper, scissor mechanics in many of these games, so some kind of meta game. So you have to know about that. You also have imperfect information because you don't know what the opponent is doing. Long-term planning, like what you do in the early part of the game has a big effect on how it turns out later. It's real time, and as I mentioned before, it has a huge action space. Like Go has an action space of 10 to the power of 780. StarCraft and Dota and so on, I think you can imagine that that is much bigger. So the fact that they're able to deal with this and are actually able to create something that can beat some of the world champions is truly impressive. But let's just step back a bit on the hype and just see, okay, what about these agents? Can we use them for our playtesting? And maybe one of the closest one is this MuZero. So it's something that they used to play, you know, Atari and these classic board games. And what I thought was pretty interesting about this is that I have this technical limitation that I can't really control the game dynamic of going back and forth between states, and it becomes a bit of a mess. And that's how it is in many cases. Like, you don't have a good simulator of the game. And what they actually do here is that they create some kind of tree search. So like I showed before, this classic approach of going to the end and planning, they can actually do that. But they don't do it from the game simulator itself. They do it from some kind of learned model. So how that looks like is that they have the board state up here, and then their model that has three components, it learns some kind of representation of this state and approximate it as. Then it also has a prediction component that estimates what is the policy, what is the action that it should take in this state, and what is the expected value of the state. Then lastly, they also have a dynamics component. So the model learns what to expect in the next steps. So they can actually do a tree search on basically this learned model. And that is what enables it to both plan and take actions very well. And, you know, it's pretty cool, this way of having something to basically a learned world model. So, okay, sounds good. Maybe let's try and use that. So to get to the next part, it looks good on paper, but as I was reading through this paper, just on the very first page, and not so far ahead in the paper in the abstract, there were some words that, you know, kind of triggered my senses. One is mastering, the other is superhuman performance. And if you just think a bit about what it is that we wanted to do to begin with, we want something that mimics the average player and use that to predict, what the average difficulty is for each level. So maybe we don't want it to master or become a superhuman performance. So it's just to see what that means is, let's just talk about how they measure the performance of this, or measure the skill of the agent they train. So in chess, you have this ELO system. So that's something where, you know, you can compare to other players of how skilled you are, and you can go up and down, and depending if you beat another player with higher ELO, and, you know, I don't know all the rules, but there's something similar in many games where your ELO or true skill or whatever is updated depending on how well you're doing towards against other players. But what about like single player games like Atari? And typically what you have in these systems is that you have some estimate of the reward that you get, and you can use that to compare to the average player reward or something like that, and, you know, then see how it compares to other players. But I mean, the level designers, I mean, how can they use this information that the reward of the agent on this level is 1,000? I mean, it doesn't convey any meaningful information to them. Plus, as I will maybe talk about in a bit, this reward function is also very dependent on how you define it. So it's a bit tricky. But of course, I mean, it's still an option. You can stop early this training, so you get an agent that is not maybe superhuman, or it has the average skill of the players, or maybe you can limit how far ahead it can plan, and maybe that's a way to then deal with this and add it or use it in your problem. But there's also the complexity of some of these systems. So if you first look at the graph and how like computationally heavy the training has been for some of these AlphaGo, Zero that can play StarCraft and so on, I mean, you can see, I don't know if any of you have worked with convolutional neural networks like ResNet or some machine translation or something like that. I mean, if you know how long it can take to train that, and then consider this is a logarithmic scale, I mean, it takes quite some time to train. And if not for time, then money. I mean, sure, with all the cloud systems, you can have 5,000 TPU tensor processing units and just train one model, but it becomes like prohibitively expensive to use some of these methods. And also maybe a bit of a selfish reason, there's also the whole research aspect. So I think for me, it's not interesting to create a bigger and crazier model. I want to like try and research some of the basic things that are not working and can just, I mean, yeah, do the same stuff, but without all this heavy computation aspect of it. So that's that. And then also other difficulties. So in reinforcement learning, when you have to define the reward, I mean, maybe it doesn't really go the way that it goes. So here you can see what happens if you, for example, instead of, or in addition to creating an agent that is supposed to finish a race, you also give it a reward for collecting these green boosters. And then at some point, your agent finds out that there's a certain place in the map where it can just loop around, collect these boosters, and it ends up with a higher reward for doing this rather than finishing the race. So that's one of the ways that it can go wrong. There's also the whole sample inefficiency. Like every time you learn a new policy, how to act, you have to test it. So you have to go play the game again and collect observations. So some of the methods can be very sample inefficient. And then stability of the algorithm. Like you can learn something that completely crashes your learning, learn something that it can't get out of some minimum. And like, how do we make sure that it generalizes to other levels? Because, I mean, if you have more than 4,000 levels, you don't want it to just try and learn the optimal method on each of them. You want it to learn to play the game. And then lastly, how do we then compare that to human behavior? So with this in mind, some of the difficulties that we have, there's the state-of-the-art reinforcement learning agents and so on, but how does this then fare when we try and use it for our own problem? So just to quickly mention what I'm working with typically with this, we use this kind of custom game environment. So we have we define our rewards where we give points for collecting the goals here, we give a penalty if it tries to perform a wrong action, we give it a penalty for every step to encourage it to move faster, and we give it a reward for completing the level. And then the way that we want to describe it is by game mechanics. Rather than taking a screenshot of the game, we try to break it down into like smaller basic parts of the game. So in this case, it's the game mechanics. So you have the colors, you have some different properties of the different pieces on the board. And that's then how we represent our state. And then lastly, we use some kind of convolutional neural network feature extractor and some output here. But that's the overall setup that we work with. And now I just want to put a few math things, because it's a shame not to mention it, but it's you don't need to really follow this to understand what's going on. So the method that we use is this PPO, proximal policy optimization, and it's a policy gradient method. What that means is that how in many machine learning problems, you have some loss function that you want to optimize, or you have some kind of function that you want to optimize, and you do that by taking the gradient and then doing some gradient descent. In this case, our function that we want to maximize is the expected reward. And it basically looks like this. So if we look at the part here, so what this is basically we have the expected reward that depends on this theta, which is our neural network weights in this case. So it's our model parameters. And we have some policy that depends on that. So this is basically for a given state, this is a sum over the possible actions in a given state. And then you have the expected reward that you get for taking that specific action in that state. So it's kind of a weighted sum, and you use the probability distribution of the policy. So what it could look like, this is kind of like an approximate drawing. If you look at the S0 here, you have two actions and you have maybe some probability to take any of them. And for each of the actions that you take, you also estimate the expected reward in the end. So you can calculate like some expectation value of the reward for being in states S0. And then lastly, what we do is then we take the sum of the all the probability distribution. So this is a distribution of all the states that we have. So not only do we weigh the value by the probability of having or taking this action, we also do it by the probability of being in that state. So we get like a weighted sum of weighted sum, and that's our expected reward. And maybe, okay, if you are still with me, great. If you're not, don't worry. The point is just, this is just important because when you want to find the gradient of this, all it depends on is our policy here. So when we want to optimize our policy, find the policy gradient, we only need to consider our policy here that is approximated by some neural network. And now a bit more math, but that's the last, I promise. PPO specifically then uses this clipped objective and a few other things. But what it does is that instead of just looking at the policy directly like this, it looks at the ratio between the policy that you get and what your old policy was. So in a way, it's to make sure that when you find a new policy, you don't deviate too much from your previous policy. So that's the main point of this clipped objective. And then there's some extra terms here. One is to make sure that your expected value is not too wrong, and the other is to encourage some kind of exploration. You don't want to be too sure that you don't want to have 100% probability of taking one action, because it's maybe you end up using only one action, and that's then you don't explore all the other options. So, you know, you also add this term to encourage it to generalize. So that was the mathy part of this. And I mean, PPO, we also chose it because it, I mean, all this is used in wide applications area. It has a wide application area from robotics and also in Unity. It has this whole library with machine learning agents where you can train your own thing, whether it's a simulation or a game or whatever. So we went with this because it's simple-ish and it's it has a pretty decent performance in various domains. But I mean, okay, this is just all acronyms, but there are tons of others that, I mean, I'm sure there will be new ones tomorrow. So it's kind of like you need to take your pick at some point. All right. So how does all this then relate to the work that we have found? Well, first, just trying out of the box using some of these methods, it was, it had still some stability issues. So you can see here, this is our training curves. So we train, the more we train here on the x-axis, we can see that there are some of these approaches that, okay, they achieve a higher reward in the beginning, but then at some point they learn some catastrophic policy and they never really recover later. So it's there was a bit of a bummer that, you know, why does it really do this? Why does it really fail? But there were also some that seemed to actually be doing reasonably well and achieve some, you know, stable performance. And that's what the like basis for one of the papers that we put out for this. And the basic idea is we suggested three strategies. One is color shuffling. So if you have something in your state that you can shuffle around and it doesn't really affect the dynamics, you know, just shuffle your data, add some noise or kind of procedurally content augment your data in a way. We also found that resetting early helps. So if it starts doing something really annoying or bad that it doesn't learn from, just stop it, start it from new and, you know, let it explore another level that it can maybe learn from. And then lastly, what we did was to have some kind of soft action mask. So maybe we have an idea of what actions that are valid, even if it's imperfect, maybe we can get, feed it with that information. So it's kind of like a partial model of the environment, kind of like this MuZero did. And what it does is, I mean, even if it's imperfect, you really boost how fast it learns something. So that tends to be a pretty good thing to add, even if it's not always correct or imperfect. So these, with these three strategies, we kind of dealt with the first like things that we had in this design guidelines. It has to fit in with the company tech. We can get it to work in Unity and everything. And we can deal with, you know, no play traces, limited control, and it seems to learn reasonably well. But now what about this last part? What about this, you know, accurate and fast predictions? So just before I talk about that, first of all, I think I need to hurry a bit up, but just before I talk about that, let's just rephrase what it is that we want to do. We want to estimate the difficulty, but what is the level difficulty and what does it mean to be human-like? So if you look here at this graph, this is a distribution of moves that players have taken to complete a level. So you can see that there's some sharp cutoff here, and that is something that happens because we have the move limit. So obviously we can't collect data for the failed attempts over here. Now I jumped a bit ahead, but first, what is difficulty? And typically we just use attempts per complete. How many attempts do people use on average to complete the level? And inversely, you can also use the completion rate. It's the same, but just, you know, one over the other. But this is just, you know, some number, but we can look in more detail because the agent, we don't limit it on how much, how many moves it can take. It can go as far, take as many moves as it wants. So what we actually get is some kind of move distribution. And some of the work that I'm doing right now is also trying to model this. And, you know, it's something that I think can be described by this kind of Poisson gamma process. So it's a negative binomial. It's something that you could also maybe expect to see, for example, in Super Mario level time to complete something. It's where you have a count of something, some Poisson process, and the intensity is then modified by this gamma distribution. In any case, the interesting thing is that maybe if players are the move distribution of players follow this kind of distribution, and maybe if our agent does it too, maybe there's some correlation between how the player and agent distribution looks like. So, to continue then, this was a small sidetrack, but let's now consider, okay, how do we actually want to use this to get interesting data out that the level designers can use? So first of all, when we want to evaluate a level, we want to maybe use it immediately, the agent immediately, so we can get a fast prediction. So can we do that with no additional training, so it's fast enough? Or if the accuracy is not good enough, if it's not too enough human-like, can we maybe add a bit of training more on this agent, on the level we want to evaluate, or just simply just start over? Just let it practice, let it master this level, and then do a prediction. So this was the kind of thoughts that prompted like another look into like what kind of training methodology should you use. And so one of the things that we saw, so we tried first of all to have a random agent, and then we also had a heuristic agent that I made, which was worse than random, so I don't know how to play the game clearly. Then we had one where we only trained on where we trained once on all available levels and tried to use it right away. And then two others where we again had the pre-trained agent and then did some additional training on the level we wanted to evaluate. And also one where we just only looked at the level. So what we saw here, so this is the move distribution again of the different agents compared to some player data. And what we see is that this two-step where we train a lot, it seems to be the most competent. And remember, this is some kind of, this is normalized, so we can't really compare exactly, but this green agent seemed to be the best. And if we also look, it's level 120. If we look at the completion rate here with the players and then this level, it seemed to actually be the one that was closest to the player data. So, okay, maybe that's how we should do it. But fortunately, it takes too long to do that. So it's not really a feasible way. But also, interestingly enough, what we saw is that if we just consider the, say, 10% best runs of each agent, and you know, we see how many moves that run took, the 10% best run, and use that to look at the correlation with the completion rate, we actually see that this one-step model, where we only train it once, actually seems to have the best correlation with the completion rate. So in a way, what we see is that when we do additional training, it actually ends up removing the correlation with the players. And it makes sense because the agent is sensitive to different parameters than players. So it's hard to predetermine how much time you should train to what reward or whatever you should train an agent, because it behaves fundamentally different than players. So what's important though is that it's consistent across levels and game mechanics, because if that is the case, then we can actually do a prediction model. So this is not a completely new idea. It's something that has been done by basically the same problem, but they didn't use reinforcement learning. They used classical convolutional neural network classifier. So what they did was that they had some agent trained this way, and then they added some layer of modeling or some binomial regression and used that to predict the completion rate. So let's just do the same. I mean, let's just make sure that the agent is consistent, because then we can at least calibrate it using this subsequent layer. So try that. And so let's say what we want to do is we want to see how many predictions per game mechanic that fall within some tolerance. So here I have all the different game mechanics kind of, and I have the fraction of levels with that game mechanic that has an error rate less than 10%. And you can see it hovers around 30%, which I mean, let's say we want to create a KPI that says how good is our coverage and how robust is our method. So we want to then maybe say, so this key performance indicator, what is the percentage of game mechanics that in 90% of the cases can be predicted with an error less than our tolerance of 10%. So using this definition and actually considering this graph, that is a big fat zero. So that's a bit disappointing. Also, maybe we're being a bit too strict on what we wanted to do, but practically speaking, this is the kind of KPI a company would be interested in, and it still seems like there's a few things to do. So just to then talk a bit about what makes sense to do next. What we want to do is we want to make sure that it's playing as consistently as possible. And you can do a number of things to encourage that. One is from, you know, change the architecture of the method or the algorithm. So you can have all these typical ways of adding or making sure that your model generalizes. Maybe there's something with the method itself that has a different generalizability score. But what is maybe a bit more immediate is to look at the data that we have and the fact that we have limited augmentation. Because what we also see is that, so in this plot here, I show a model that is trained on only a single level, and I see how it performs on the other levels. So in a way, measuring the generalizability of an agent trained on a single level. These levels are all comparable with each other. So, so what we can see is that some training on some levels, some of these models are inherently better than the others. So maybe there is some best level for training rather than just picking it randomly. Maybe we should be a bit more clever with how we actually train our agent. And also just a side note on this, I mean, one thing that you would see is that if you have a sequential task, so let's say you want to train something, so it's called catastrophic forgetting. So when you train on model A or task A, you decrease the loss of that. So you improve the performance on task A. Then you have task B and try to train your model on that. And at, what you see is that, okay, you decrease the, you increase the performance on task B, but you also worsen the performance on task A. So you forget what you have learned. And this is particularly maybe interesting to keep in mind because that's something during training that affects it during training, how we sample levels. Or when we have new levels or mechanics, like should we just restart the agent and do this all over, or how do we actually best train it on new levels? So this is the whole, a whole topic of like lifelong learning and so on. And I don't have time to talk about that, but the takeaway point is that maybe we should not master one level at a time. So just to quickly give my thoughts, what I think would make sense is to look at some kind of curriculum learning. And that is where you, you know, normally you can have like an, you know, you can arrange your levels or tasks in with increasing difficulty. And then, you know, as the agent masters one, it can go to the next, but you can also do it in an automatic way. And the good thing is that, I mean, it's really a multi-purpose way. So you can do it to increase generalization and hard tasks, but it's also something that is multifunctional. So you can make sure that you increase the diversity of your agent, like the more diverse training and so on your agent has, the more it tends to generalize. And you don't need to maybe specify, maximize the reward on this level. It's also something where you can, you know, maximize the overall performance on all levels. So you take the global learning progress into account. So with that in mind, and what I think would make sense is to look into something where you have some diversity in some skills that they learn. Like that, there's this paper, diversity is all you need. So what you encourage is to have some skills that are as random and uncorrelated as possible and maximize the diversity in those. And what you see is that the more skills your agent gets and the more training you do, the more it it's able to actually deal with some of these typical hard to deal with the reinforcement learning scenarios. And that's maybe also relevant for us because we have little levels that are designed with different solutions in mind. So something like this would maybe be very important to include. And lastly, we want to be smarter with our curriculum. We want to have some sample levels that encourage the consistency across tasks, more levels at once, and also mixes skill into the thing. So unfortunately, this is still work in progress, and I don't really have any cool graphs to show, so this all stays at the theoretical part. But that is basically it. So I will just wrap it up. And so what we talked about, I mean, so state-of-the-art reinforcement learning is impressive. It can deal with some very tricky domains. Using it in a production environment like a company, it is also possible, and there are a couple of strategies that you can use to that, so that's fine. But getting it to mimic players, it can be a bit tougher, but it's not impossible. What you just have to make sure is consistency that is important, because then you can always have it some subsequent analysis or some subsequent modification of your agent, so you can actually predict player behavior. And the way that I think would make sense to do it is generalization through curricula. Some, not all levels are equal also when it comes to training. So that's worth it to keep in mind. And maybe diversity in the skills that an agent can acquire is also key to being able to play different levels and new levels and be able to use it in a production environment. So yeah, with that last bit in mind, just want to say there's this conference on games. So that was also the one that I met Milos in London in 19. It's going to take place in Copenhagen. So I hope that some of you would be interested in that. And I will actually be hosting a playtest agent competition. So you can also play around with this if you found it interesting. And the link is here. So yes, with that, I want to say thanks for your attention and I hope you enjoyed it.
Thank you, Jeppe, for a great presentation. I enjoyed it and hopefully the others did. So of course, there is time for questions. So if you want, you can use the questions and answer dialogue to put your questions in and Jeppe will answer them. You can also write on chat if that's more convenient, it's fine. So while we wait for questions, I have one of my own. Did you maybe consider to use this model for a way to predict player skill?
In a way, yes. I'm not completely sure how it could be linked, but I think this then becomes a bit more towards just the modeling of the player data itself. So trying to understand how players are actually playing the game. I'm not sure it's easier to use a playtest agent for that, but I mean, it is one of the things like, how do we actually measure player skill? And since we don't really have a good way of maybe doing it for players, it's also hard to then do it for the agent itself, other than just the completion rate. But I think the hard part is also we don't have so fine-grained player data, so we don't know in what detail they are pressing. So the agent is very good at, like, we can easily record what it's doing on each move and in one level, like get all that data, but we don't really have that for players. So it becomes a bit different data issues. So I think the first step in this modeling player skill is related to this negative binomial distribution of the agent or of the move distributions. And then somehow use more traditional methods to relate that to player completions.
Mm-hmm. Okay, cool. Thank you. I understand. That's very interesting. Okay, I think we have one question. We have one question that is two questions. I don't know if you can see it.
Yeah, I don't know how it's easy. I can answer live. So since puzzle games are most of the time represented in a grid-like manner with fields in which are connected, would the agent benefit from architectures like convolutional recurrent neural networks for feature extraction? Yes, it's actually one of the things that I did want to try. So it's one way to keep memory of what you have been doing and then use that to basically plan. So it is something that I wanted to get around to, but I didn't actually do it, but definitely it's one way, adding like a long short-term memory cell or something in your neural network could definitely improve, I think, both performance, but also planning and deal with this whole thing of some mechanics that require it kind of, some mechanics kind of break this assumption that the previous state doesn't affect the next one. So it's definitely something that would be useful. The maximum number of moves per level, is that something that is the same for each difficulty level? And if not, if that would be beneficial for the agent when playing the game. It is something that I think could be, I mean, so the maximum number of levels the maximum number of moves per level is not something that is the same across levels. It's a whole distribution. It's typically between 30 and 45. So it ranges, and it's one of the parameters that level designers change to be able to adjust the difficulty. Whether the agent could use it or not, I mean, it's one of the things that I have thought about. How would I include that, and how would that help decide, or how would that help make the agent more human-like? I just think that it becomes a bit, you put some restrictions on the agent, then, I mean, we already reset if it trains for too long on a level. So I'm not sure if there would be any value of it knowing what the move limit would be, because basically at each step, you know how many moves you have and how many collect goals you have. So it's not, maybe if you knew how many moves that you need to maybe finish, it would be something that could allow it to plan. But as it is, like, you know, maybe there could be some value in knowing how many moves do you have left to complete this goal. And that's the same that you would have at each step. Yeah, I didn't try it because I think it's a bit tricky to get player data and relate that during training of the agent also without compromising some kind of, I mean, how would you also define the reward function? Or yeah, I don't know. I think it would be useful. You could include it in some way in your architecture, and maybe it would help, but I didn't actually try it, is what I'm trying to say.
Thanks. Let's wait for a bit. Maybe we'll have more questions.
In the meantime,
and I guess, while we wait, I can ask you again. Did you actually try to train one of those, you know, MuZero, AlphaZero models? And did you see the performance, or you never tried to train at all?
It's again one of my things that I would like to do. We actually, one of the things that we hope to both do with this competition, but also there are lots of students at the IT university. It would be very cool to do a more like method comparison thing, but it's just this industrial PhD and trying to find time between, you know, getting something that we have to work and experimenting with things. It's a kind of hard balance sometimes. So I haven't had time to do it yet, but it's one thing that I actually thought while working for this presentation that, I mean, maybe we should just try and do it, see how it performs. So, yeah.
Yeah, I think that would be like fun at least. Just to try and see. Yeah.
Is it something that you have experience with?
Maybe. Maybe we can talk when we're not recording. Yes.
No, sure. But I mean, it's there's a lot of ideas on how you can, what you can do, what methods that might be possible. But at some point, at least when it comes to research and, you know, you have some time restrictions, you also want to try and make an impact on what you're doing and not just take a solution and use it. So we have kind of stuck with one method, but I mean, things evolve all the time, so it's hard to keep up with all the newest research. But some of it is super promising.
Yeah. So let's wait for one more minute to see if we will have some more questions. Please don't be shy to ask. I don't think we are gonna have more questions. Okay, so thank you once again for this great presentation. For all the participants, this will be shared at some point on the Nordia channels. So if you want to have another watch, you will be able to. So yeah, thank you. Thank you, Jeppe. And I really hope that we can do this again when you have more results to see what is going on. And hopefully, maybe somebody from the audience will join the competition and make AI agents for your game.
There are prizes. Yes. Thanks for having me.
Yeah. So thank you all. Thank you for joining. We have come to the end, and hopefully see you once more in our fourth Bye AI meetup. Bye-bye.